This is a download from BFM 89.9, the business station.
Good afternoon, this is Tech Talk. I'm Jeff Sandhu. Now, Anonymous, Lulzsec, Rooted, Legion of Doom, and many more have somehow become household names in some way. Now, these hacker groups that have been garnering a lot of media attention. And here with me today is Drew Williams. He's the CEO for Condition Zebra to talk about computer and web security risk. Now, Drew, thank you again for spending time with us.
Yeah, thanks for letting me join you today.
As mentioned early on, you know, there seems to be a growing number of reports in the media on hacking, and you know, even we are talking about this as of today. And I know, is this like a growing problem, or is this just media hype?
I think it's a combination of a growing concern, and I think it's extraordinarily inflated by the media. However, the real problem isn't about the hacking, it's about how they're getting in, which often has to do with obvious errors in systems. Hackers don't like to work very hard to get into systems. They just take advantage of problems that are currently already in the system.
Now, you know, why does it seem that it's, you know, it's sort of getting more press? Because it's been around for ages now, but it's only in the past few years that, you know, we media guys like us are picking this up and talking about it.
Yeah, I think it's because of the extent of damage associated with reputation. You know, the big push, at least on this side of the planet, is focusing on disclosure and the embarrassment that comes from having to disclose as a large company, hey, we've been hacked, we've compromised these customer records, we've compromised these assets, and by law we have to disclose them. And that really does have a tremendous negative impact on the revenue and long-term success and growth of a company, even a small one.
Has the damage cost sort of increased over the past few years?
Yeah, I think it's increased because as more companies rely more on the internet and rely more on their web presence, you know, we're becoming a very switched-on system kind of culture worldwide. And, as we continue to turn more toward online commerce, and certainly in the mobile space, that's another thing that's really we're seeing is as long as we continue to move toward a mobile computing environment rather than a desktop station environment, you're going to see a lot of increase in this kind of area.
So is this more like an industry problem or a consumer problem or even a regional problem?
No, I think this is an age-old argument about how much work do I put into the attention to detail of my system. We know that 90%, some statistics will show 85 or 80, whatever, it doesn't matter. I think it's about 90. 90% of all security compromises happen because something wasn't configured properly behind the firewall. Something happened internally. An error in the system, the way the system was scripted. And they leave open doors, you know, default services left on, old accounts, expired accounts with current passwords or no passwords. I mean, this is how most of these guys are getting into the system. And as long as people are still not taking care of their infrastructure, they're going to have this problem.
So just going back to that, is there a specific industry that should be concerned?
The ones that are targeted the most are obviously the consumer-based industries. Banking is obviously a huge, huge, huge target. It's probably number two behind defense. E-commerce, you know, as long as you check out who you're doing business with and see how their, you know, systems are set up. But consumers, generally speaking, don't have a lot to worry about because if they're using credit cards, you know, those credit card companies are insuring, you know, the use of those cards. So up to a certain dollar point or ringgit point or whatever currency you're talking about, it's insured if fraud or something happens to it, compromises the integrity of that credit. If they're using their own cash, like in a debit card situation, then they could be pose huge consequences by not having a backup to support that or to restore lost expenses. But generally speaking, we're talking about shareholder confidence and consumer trust and satisfaction across the board. But primarily we're talking banking, but that doesn't leave out big companies like Sony, for example, which lost $1 billion, you know, because of this problem. And, you know, and other companies, Yahoo, even the security companies like, you know, Big Yellow, Symantec, you know, which is a company I helped create, you know, it in the security space, it got hacked. I mean, nobody is immune to this.
So, you know, this kind of activities, they've been going on for a long time now. You know, is it changing so fast that, you know, our people seems to have a problem in responding to it?
The thing is, you know, honestly, from an analytical perspective, I think it has to has more to do with the human element, because in the IT space or the computing space or web development space, it is such a rapidly growing and expanding industry that employees are usually switching companies every, you know, 22-24 months, and a lot of times they're moving along or moving up the ranks, and the guys behind them are not, you know, left with a lot of confidence with what was left behind, because, you know, they often will like to rebuild things or do things to their style. And so it introduces a lot of inconsistency in how systems are architected and configured and managed. And so that, of course, then breeds all kinds of technologies and products that people try to implement, and there's a lot of disparate, you know, capabilities with those products and technologies, and that creates new holes and new vulnerabilities, and those too become exploit targets and easy access points for people who want to cause trouble.
I'm speaking to Drew Williams. He's the CEO of Conditioned Zebra, and we're talking about computer and web security risk, and in just a moment we'll talk about how this is impacting businesses here in Malaysia. BFM 89.9. Jeff Sandu here, and with me today is Drew Williams. He's the CEO for Conditioned Zebra, and today we are talking about computer and web security risk. And early on we spoke about, you know, what are some of the industries that should be concerned. Now, Drew, you know, Malaysia is a long way from US and Europe, and, you know, is this trend something, you know, that's going to impact our business here, you know, in Malaysia, or is it as a country directly?
You know, I think you are in an amazing position. This country has so much going for it because it doesn't have to rely on a hardwired system. You know, your infrastructure is all modern. It's virtual. Unfortunately, with that comes additional risk that you are more susceptible to the common trends associated with, you know, wireless security and wireless, you know, or not wireless, but mobile infrastructures. And is it a trend that's growing? Yes. Now, here's the thing. You are a long way from the U.S., however, Malaysia's government, and we were with them this week, their cybersecurity national policies have a lot to do with basing arguments on critical infrastructure policies created by the U.S. National Institute of Standards and Technology. That is a great starting point to create, you know, policies of use and, you know, considering, you know, how technology is implemented. However, the argument that I made to the government was, you are a very unique country, and you have a very unique set of processes and styles. Your geographic location, you're aligned with the third busiest waterway in the world. There are lots of very unique things about this country that would warrant the country itself to consider creating, you know, borrowing what they can, because you don't ever want to reinvent the wheel, but borrowing what they can from other proven infrastructure security policies, but creating their own very unique policy for this very unique region of the world. And I think that would go a great, and that's certainly one of the things that we're doing, and we're helping, you know, the nation in that space. But you know, commerce here, you know, we talk about compliance. Compliance rules like Sarbanes-Oxley or ISO standards, they are a nice to have, bordering on need to have. They're not really yet edict or mandate must have. There's not a lot of teeth behind them unless you're doing business internationally with other companies. And I think that's a good thing, because it'll allow Malaysia to evaluate, you know, where the levels of criticality are in their infrastructure, certainly in their computing infrastructure, and then target what they really need. You know, and our approach and our philosophy, which is what we try to, which I'm trying to help, you know, explain to Malaysia's, you know, sectors is, first, identify what you have. Second, identify what you know. And then third, apply that to what you need. And that's a better way of addressing these kinds of risks rather than just adopting, you know, a vanilla policy from some other organization or some other entity that, you know, is not even in the same, you know, hemisphere.
But do we share the same threats as the U.S. and Europe?
Oh, yes. Yeah. I mean, the Internet is the Internet, right? And the web is the web. Europe, the U.S., here, Asia in general, Australia, Africa, they're all connected. And if you're doing business online, if you're banking online, if you are buying and selling commodities online, you are at risk. You know, the globe of technology is just simply a click away, and you know, you don't have sectioned off areas of the world like you do with physical geographic locations.
Now, you know, what's the difference between computer security and risk management?
Huge difference. Computer security is about looking after your IT computing infrastructure, ensuring that you are protecting the assets and responding to problems associated with threats or attacks or vulnerabilities. Risk management is actually a business driver. You can consider computer security as a technical aspect of an organization, whereas risk management is a business driver. You know, you look at risk management as saying, all right, we are preparing to acquire, let's say, another company, or we want to open another facility at another area, either in our country or another country. What will be the associated risks with doing that? So in that case, not all risk is bad, but they are all measurable. And risk management has then with it a set of consequences. Well, if we do this, you know, what is the then statement? If this happens, then what occurs? And risk management is something that takes into account computer security while not ignoring the needs of the business by way of, you know, profitability, growth, progress, expansion, and so on.
So, you know, where does computer hacking then fits into risk management?
Yeah, see, computer hacking, that's the consequence of not doing something poorly at first. And risk management is something that can reduce the risk of computer hacking. You know, computer hacking is a computer security outcome, right? Hacking is an outcome of people doing things that are inappropriate, that yield to a result that would not be expected if they were to operate under normal conditions, and obviously often has to do with a hostile outcome. However, in risk management, if you're evaluating, for example, a cyber risk management model, you're looking at your infrastructure and saying, okay, we know that the bad guys will come in most likely on these types of attacks, and they're pretty documented. There's nothing new here. They've been around since the 90s. Then if that's true, then what can we do in our infrastructure to reduce our, what I call our IT footprint or our risk footprint, to reduce the likelihood that we could suffer loss because of that particular kind of hack?
Now, you know, when we're talking about risk, you know, how does it apply to a typical, a company here, for example, a company here in Malaysia, you know, is there like a rules to follow, or, you know, a standard set or procedures that we can prevent risk?
Yeah, first of all, you can't really prevent risk. You can only manage it. And, I mean, obviously you can prevent some risk, you know, unplug the system, you know. You know, if you want to reduce risk in, you know, from getting in a car accident, don't get in the car, and certainly don't get in a car in Malaysia at 5 in the afternoon, you know, or ride a scooter or whatever. You know, risk management has to do with planning. Are there policies and procedures? Yes, there's a lot of them. You can look at frameworks like COBIT, or obviously the ISO standards. 27001 is obviously the one everybody's going after because it's the whole ISMS certification thing. But if you think about it, that's a starting point. Every company like Yahoo, these latest victims, Amazon, Sony, they were all ISO compliant. They were all Sarbanes-Oxley and PCI DSS compliant. And PCI DSS applies to the payment card industry and how you manage credit cards and online transactions. They were all in compliance, and yet they still lost millions and millions of dollars because of these things, because they didn't look at their infrastructure. They were going for the easy fix by simply looking over the policy. And, you know, having been involved early in authoring some of these international policies, like the healthcare policy and the COBIT framework, I can tell you that when we wrote those original rule sets, it was to give people guidelines for how they should consider risk management from a cybersecurity perspective. It wasn't to say, follow this and you will be protected. What it says is do these things at a bare minimum and you'll at least meet some common level of expectation. You know, one, for example, will say implement a firewall. One will say we'll implement an antivirus tool. Well, that's great, but if you don't configure the firewall, what kind of firewall? Is it a network firewall? Is it a web access or a web firewall? What kind of antivirus tool is it? And what kind of risks are you looking at trying to identify with respect to implementing an antivirus tool? Do you need more? Are there other devices? What does our web vulnerability presence look like? You know, you can't just go out and take a policy or a framework and drop it in and say, yeah, we're safe, because obviously Sony and their $1 billion loss in shareholder value, you know, could say, well, we did that and look what it got us.
So, you know, this sounds like there's a lot of things that needs to be considered. So what's the first step that a company should do right now in order to reduce risk?
Very first thing, and it's what I tell every potential client and every customer, assess what your footprint looks like today. Evaluate what are your operational standards and identify your infrastructure and how you use it. What kind of devices are you running? What kind of systems are you running? And then, based on what tools are you using? How do you write a password? Where do you store that information? Where are your critical assets stored? On what kind of devices? Then you at least know, you know, remember what I talked about in the beginning, is first of all, you want to identify, you know, what you know and then what you have, and then identify what you need. So then you know what you have, and then you go out and identify, all right, what are the risks, technical risks, technology risks, the vulnerabilities associated with these tools and these tactics? Is it I need to restructure my configuration for my firewall? Is it that I need to look at my risk for cross-site scripting on my web pages? Are my forms being filled out properly? What's the length of my passwords? Are they working properly? So that's where you really start, because you can do, you know, probably half of the work by simply doing your homework and doing a little housekeeping.
I've been speaking to Drew Williams, the CEO for Condition Zebra, talking about computer and web security risk and steps that you should take for your company. BFM 89.9.
Thank you for listening to this podcast. To find more great interviews, go to bfm.my or find us on iTunes. BFM 89.9, the business station.